Hello friends, welcome back to javanines.com. I'm Srinivas. In this session, we're going to discuss about the key differences between object-oriented approach and functional approach of programming. It is very important to understand the fundamental details as most of the changes to Java 8 were introduced to support functional programming. In previous sessions, I've explained two important properties of functions. One is avoiding mutable states. Second one was about functions being stateless. It is important to have an idea about these two concepts to have a better understanding on fundamentals of functional programming. So if you did not watch them, I recommend you to follow the links provided in the suggestions. So let us get started. First, let us have a short look at the object-oriented approach. Object-oriented programming is the most successful programming approach. In this, it is very easy to model complex domains and represent real world. Here, everything is an object. An object has state and behavior. So we represent state as variables and behaviors as methods. For example, take a car type, which has distance traveled, fuel, and color as states, and move as its behavior. Then take this driver type who has state as name, age, etc. and then drive as its behavior. The drive method invokes the car's move method, and move method in turn modifies the states like distance traveled, fuel, etc. From this we can understand that it is easy to simulate or represent real world with object-oriented approach. But there is something specific we need to notice here. If you closely observe the applications developed in OOPS concept, what you can infer is that when applications are being used, the state of the objects are getting updated, new instances are created, and some old instances are getting garbage collected. So the primary thing that is happening here is that the state of the objects are updated by methods. Now, coming to functional programming, we got to come out of the object-oriented approach and understand functional approach with different kind of scenario. The idea of functional programming is actually based on mathematics. It was in 1930, Alonzo Church developed the concept of lambda calculus. Then another concept from Haskell Curry, who introduced the combinatory logic, helped in improving the foundations of mathematics. I'm not going to talk about their theories or any mathematics here, but it is important to understand how this concept is applied in functional programming. Let us take this simple function where f of x is equal to x squared. Now we have another function g of a comma b is equal to a squared plus b squared plus 2ab. Then based on the above definitions, I can simplify g of a comma b equation as f of a plus f of b plus 2ab. This g of a comma b is called higher order function because it is using other functions for its calculation. The reason I was able to replace certain parts of g of a comma b is that f of x is an independent one without any side effects, and its results are going to be consistent. So if you represent this in programming, I can write the code something like this, and you can see that I have represented square as a separate function, then I have a sum method, and then I have finally g of a comma b representation as a sum square method. So this is how we can represent these functions into programming. Now, one important point we should understand with respect to mathematics is that when I substitute x is equal to 3, we simply get 9 as a result for f of x. There are no external influences which affect these functions in mathematics, okay? But when it comes to programming, we have to store the values in variables which are placed at a memory location. Now, this particular variable, which is a state, can be modified by other objects or possibly by multiple threads. So in programming, there is a chance that functions can get affected because, you know, some objects or threads could modify the variables that have been passed around as an input. During the execution, if some other thread or object modifies this variable, then functions are not going to be side effect free and the results are not going to be consistent. So to ensure that this does not happen, pure functional programming languages make variables as immutable. That means When you create a variable and assign a value, we will never be able to modify it. So this way we can ensure that functions does not have any external influences during their execution. But now you might be thinking that how can we run an application without modifying anything? So finally, it is all about updating the data, right? Generally, to solve this problem, whenever data or state has to be updated, functional programming languages create a new copy of object and set the updated state instead of modifying the same object which is given as an input to the function. Another reason behind avoiding change of states is to avoid concurrency issues. We have already discussed this in our previous session. When we consider object-oriented programming and functional programming, we need to remember that there are different tools to address different problems. Not everything can be developed efficiently with object-oriented programming, and it is not relevant to use functional programming language for everything. So let us take a look at what kind of program problems we can address with this functional programming. When we talk about functions, we have to think about IO, that is input and output. So a function is like a pipe or a processing chamber in a factory. You give an input as a raw material and you get an output. So it is also common that the outcome of one process is an input for another process. Take for example a steel factory, where the first process is that we clean up the ore and process it and then send it to furnace chambers. Finally, we send them to molds to create some shapes, and finally the molded steel is going to come out of the factory. So here you can see that outcome of one process becomes an input of another. Similarly, with respect to functions, the outcome of one function can be input for another function. This helps in simplifying complex calculations or expressions into simple ones. Then another problem is about parallel processing. Functions being independent and side effect free, we can go ahead and make them execute on different processors in parallel and feed them independent data sets. This way, our applications will run much faster by leveraging multi-core processors. What are the best areas where I can apply functional programming? Functional programming languages have the capacity to process continuous streams. This is the reason why functional programming languages like Scala are preferred for big data projects and web analytics. So when you have a continuous stream of data like analytics information or audio streams or any other input, then functions are the best things to handle them. The next advantage we get is that we are reducing the concurrency issues, and we will be able to process data in parallel with multi-core processors. I hope that I was able to give a good picture of functional programming, how it works, and some fundamentals behind it. So before concluding this session, there are two important points we got to remember when we are working with functional style programming. First one is that your input for functions should stay immutable so that it does not affect your function's consistency while execution. Second, your function should not involve in modifying anything outside the scope of it, but it should just focus on the input and output. So I hope that I gave you a good start functional programming. So we are now ready to start with learning Java 8 features. If you have any questions, please post them as a comment. Do not forget to like this video and share it with your friends. In the next session, I'm going to talk about lambda expressions. Until then, have a nice day and bye for now.